Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for participating today. I'm Alta Prinsloo. I'm an executive director at IFAC, and I'm working with Kevin Dancy, our CEO, and Anne-Marie Vitale, the chair of the Transition Advisory Group, as well as the deputy chair and soon-to-be chair of the IAESB on this exciting project. I'm going to ask Kevin to start with a few words, and Kevin is then going to hand over to Anne-Marie before we go into the detail. Over to you, Kevin.
Thanks, Alta. Thanks to all those on the call today. Just a couple of comments I'd like to make at the top side to frame the issue in terms of why this EE initiative is ongoing. And it's really three main points. The first is that education, international professional development is a very significant big issue. And arguably within the profession, there is no larger issue than in ensuring that not only future professional accountants, but current professional accountants are fit for purpose with the right skills going forward. This is a very significant issue for us, and it's a very important and a critical part of IFAC's strategy going forward. So in that sense, we're looking at doing more in this space rather than less in terms of going forward. Second major issue is that the remit of the panel and of this group going forward will be broader than what the standard setting remit was of the Education Board in the past. Yes, the maintenance of the standards is still a significant issue and will be an important issue for the panel going forward, but also issues of thought leadership, guidance, etc. So we really want a broader remit, a broader mandate for this panel going forward. And to dovetail that with our capacity building initiatives to ensure we build strong PAOs going forward. So those are, you know, two main issues. And the third main issue is simply that IFAC is a small organization. We have about 80 people within IFAC, 30 within standard setting, and 50 on the IFAC side of the house. So we're a relatively small organization. And to really accomplish all of the things we want to accomplish, we really have to leverage all of the good work that is done by the member bodies and the form of firms. And we believe through this initiative that a key aspect of it will be to leverage all that good work that goes on within the network. So again, to sum up the rationale for this initiative is that education is a very important issue for us. The remit of the education panel will be broader than the standards board going forward. And leverage. It's just going to be very important for us to leverage the work of the member bodies, and we believe that a panel structure within IFAC is best positioned to do that. And Marie, I'll just pass it off to you now.
Thank you so much, Kevin. I appreciate that, and certainly appreciate your support throughout this process. I would like to specifically thank Alta and her team, and also the members of the Transition Advisory Group for really providing insight and support for the development of the model. Significant progress has been made, and I think we're well positioned in achieving the Transition Advisory Group's objectives, which we'll talk about further here in a second. I think we can all acknowledge that we live in a very fast-changing environment, and the way business is being conducted is changing significantly, and is having an impact on the accountancy profession. And because of that, I think there's an opportunity, and I think everyone recognized that there was an opportunity, if not a need, to really step back and think about the effectiveness and the efficiency of developing and promoting competencies, skills, and behaviors of aspiring and professional accountants. And we believe the model is one way in which this can be achieved and further drive the profession. I think what's key about this, and as Kevin had mentioned briefly as well, is it's comprehensive, and that's important here. It is a comprehensive model. It focuses on something that we think is very important, and that's capacity building. And it's also going to take the benefit of some good work that's already been done. So let's recognize that some member organizations have done a tremendous job, and how can others benefit from that? And because of that, I think it's going to actually bring in more ideas, more insight than perhaps you'd otherwise get if it was just coming directly from IFAC or from the Education Standards Board. And those are very important aspects of it. And I'm excited about this, and Alta will go through it in more detail. But one thing that's very important here is to get the comments and the input of everyone who's participating in this webinar. So that is certainly encouraged along the way. Thank you. And also, I'll turn it back to you.
Thank you so much, Kevin. Thank you, Anne-Marie. A brief overview of the presentation today. I will briefly touch on the objectives of this initiative, share with you the progress to date, go into detail as to the model to advance international accountancy education in the future, also discuss the future of the current IAESB pronouncements, and how we plan to continue the stakeholder engagement work already underway within the IAESB. We will also touch on next steps. After that, I will ask Anne-Marie to share with you the work that the IAESB is currently doing to facilitate a successful transition to this model. And then we will have time for observations and questions. And I am encouraging you during the presentation to send any observations and questions that you may have on the GoToWebinar chat function, or you can email them directly to my colleague, Maria. Maria is here ready to go through the observations, questions, pull out the themes. And as I said, at the end, we will have an opportunity to touch on those. I also want to make you aware at this time that before the end of the week, we are planning to send you a survey. And the survey is really based on today's presentation. It outlines the model and it asks you to indicate your level of agreement with different level and with different aspects of the model. So if you do not have a chance today to make an observation or raise a question, or if we do not have a chance to respond, please know that you will have ample opportunity until around January 20th to respond and indicate your level of agreement via the survey. Again, I am saying level of agreement because the survey we are hoping will be at a level where it would be easy and quick for you to complete it, and it would help us to test the temperature and to see where are the areas of greatest concern and provide us then with an opportunity to deep dive in those areas. So in this presentation, I would like to talk about the why, the what, the how, as well as advice, access, and advocacy. Looking at the why, on the screen you see a number of macro trends. Those have been identified by IFAC and the IAESB, and we do recognize that they have a direct implication for the accountancy's profession and the accountancy profession's approach to accountancy education in the future. And for that reason, we are starting to take steps to address these implications. So within our IFAC strategy, as Kevin said, accountancy education remains a key strategic priority. And the steps that we have taken to date to advance this model is first, we have announced the transition in August 2018. That announcement came from both IFAC and the IAESB. We have also established a multi-stakeholder advisory group to advise staff on the establishment of the model. And we have worked with this advisory group and developed an outline of the model during October and November. And it is really this outline that we are sharing with you today. And again, as I have said, will also be covered in the survey that we will send out. So a bit more about the model. The model is really focused on agility, integration, and efficiency. And it would be important for you not to think of the model as a replacement of the IAESB. So it's not as though we have a panel or a board replacing another board. The model is wider. It is a comprehensive, integrated approach to accountancy education. which leverage existing resources, both internally and externally, in the most effective and efficient way, and provides for agility. Our focus is to assist professional accountancy organizations to prepare future-ready professionals. And when you have a look at IFAC's vision, of course, those professionals are essential to achieving strong, sustainable organizations, financial markets, and economies. So a high-level overview of the model. So in working on the outline of the model, we have identified in consultation with the advisory groups four guiding principles to frame the model. And those are on the screen: relevant, responsive, effective, and open. What do we mean? Relevant. The model has to address topical issues that reflect current and future needs of stakeholders, going beyond today's accountancy competencies. Responsive. The model has to have the capacity to respond to relevant issues in a timely, agile, impactful manner. Effective. It has to be a comprehensive and integrated approach, leveraging internal and external resources for maximum impact and public benefit. And lastly, it has to be open, multi-stakeholder engagement, and wide and free access to deliverables. And as I go through the rest of the model, keep us to those, and in the end, let us know whether you believe whether we have changed, whether we have achieved these guiding principles. We have also identified the primary audience of the model. Now, bearing in mind, this is a model that is comprehensive, it is integrated, and it has a wide mandate. And we are saying that our primary audience would be IFAC member organizations and aspiring IFAC member organizations. Nevertheless, we do recognize that there is a wide and diverse range of stakeholders interested in accountancy education. And if you look to the left on the screen, you will go back to open, where we have an absolute focus on multi-stakeholder engagement. And as I go through the model, you will see how we have built that into the model, making sure it is not left behind. So let's move to the what. The scope of activities that we are envisaging under this model would be the IAESB pronouncements as we know them, including the IESs. It would be thought leadership, particularly focused on future-ready professional accountants. It would also focus on adoption and implementation, and the importance of capacity building to support adoption and implementation. Advocacy would be key, really raising awareness of the importance of accountancy education as the foundation of the accountancy profession, and the need for future-ready professional accountants to support our vision of professional accountants being essential to strong, sustainable organizations, financial markets, and economies. And when we look at our current strategy, the IFAC strategy that was approved in November by our council, the title is Build Trust, Inspire Confidence. And we really believe that accountancy education is the foundation to equipping professional accountants to be able to build that trust. And then also included in the scope of activities, as I have said earlier, we are focusing on multi-stakeholder engagement. So how do we plan to implement and operate this model? So the model will be IFAC-led, and we are focusing on what I call CCL. It will focus on coordination, collaboration, and leveraging. And that would be in relation to resources internal to IFAC, which we have listed there in the green block. Most importantly, external resources. And as Kevin said, really making use of existing resources already available within our member organizations, the form of firms, the standard setting boards, global network, which includes our regional organizations and our accountancy groupings, academics and development partners. In our earlier webinar, we had a question around professional accountancy organizations being a wide spectrum. So on the one hand, you have developed professional accountancy organizations, and on the other end, you would have developing. And so the question was, how will we make sure that all professional accountancy organizations on the spectrum would benefit from the new model? And so if I start at the developing end, of course, the work that we will be doing in adoption and implementation would be essential. But if I move to the end of the developed member organizations, I can see how those member organizations could benefit from the work that they are already doing in looking into the future and preparing professional accountants for the future. And of course, the model provides an opportunity for these professional accountancy organizations on the developed side of the spectrum to provide and assist with capacity building on the developing side of the spectrum. And then lastly, bringing all of this together under a global knowledge exchange platform. We are currently building a new IFAC website, and there will be a really large focus on global knowledge, and we see this platform as being integrated within the new IFAC website and including matters such as the IESs, non-authoritative guidance tools, thought leadership, publications and research, stakeholder engagement, later maybe in a phase two, even discussion fora, and then of course also dealing with PAO capacity building in this forum. So a very important part of the model is addressing the strategic advice, access and advocacy aspect of the model. And that is the International Accountancy Education Panel. And we had another comment in the previous webinar, which was about terminology. And at the moment, we are using International Accountancy Education as a working title, and we will internally further consider what would be the best way to really communicate the broad mandate of this model. So under the panel, we foresee the panel doing several things. When we look at access would come back to the concept of collaboration, coordination, and leveraging. So really providing access to external resources. When we look at advocacy, it comes back to what I said earlier, making sure that there is sufficient awareness of the importance or the essential role of future-ready accountants within the economy. And then, of course, most importantly, strategic advice. And this is strategic advice to IFAC staff. And that would cover matters such as trends, the education aspect of our strategy and work plan, the outputs from the model, the need to revise new IESs or develop implementation guidance, and thought leadership development. So an overview of the structure of the model would be, on the one hand, on the left, as we said, this is an IFAC-led or staff-led model, where IFAC staff reporting to the CEO would be responsible for the implementation and operation of the model. IFAC staff would be advised by the panel, and the panel would also be responsible, as we have said earlier, to facilitate access to expertise and resources, as well as advocating. And then all of that is under oversight of the IFAC board, where the IFAC board oversees staff's implementation and operation of the model, and is also responsible for approving the appointment of the panel chair and panel membership, as well as overseeing the panel activities. Thinking back about our earlier webinar, another question that we have received was, how would the panel interface with the IFAC board? I have to say that we have not advanced the implementation or thinking around the implementation of the model that far. It did come up in an earlier discussion of the advisory group, and we said it could take many forms. For example, it could be a periodic written report to the IFAC board. It could also be the chair reporting periodically to the IFAC board. Now, I know that you are already thinking about the implementation and what would be necessary for this to be successful. And we found that in many of our conversations with the advisory group, we normally get stuck here because we can build the best model, but if we do not have certain factors in place, the model will not be successful. So we have grouped those factors into four categories, starting with strategic focus. Here we are saying for the model to be successful, accountancy education has to remain a strategic focus of IFAC. We also look at relevance and status of outputs. We have a lot, we've had a lot of debate within the advisory group around establishing a fit for purpose process that would remain, that would enable us to continue to have key stakeholder support for the model and for the output, and that the output would be regarded as credible and that it would be internationally recognized and applied. Under sufficient resources, our conversations included the panel having the right membership, both at level expertise. We spoke about the member organizations and the forum of firms and other stakeholders' willingness to continue to make expertise available to IFAC, as well as leveraging their work. And we have spoken about IFAC and saying the need for IFAC to be sufficiently resourced and for those resources to be of the right quality. And again, under this sufficient resources, the focus, remember, would be that we collaborate, we coordinate, and we leverage, and that that becomes a reality. We had a question earlier around how would we staff this particular activity and have we thought about how many staff members we would need? Actually, we do not necessarily see it as a siloed activity. When we come back to the fact that the approach is one that is comprehensive and integrated, we have started conversations within IFAC as to how do we structure ourselves to make sure that we really fully leverage the resources across all the activities within IFAC. And then we have discussed our fourth success factor category, effective operations. And we have spoken about the fact that it has to be, the model has to be agile, and that we really have to make use of technology so that there is a platform, a knowledge exchange platform. And again, as I said, just before we move to this category, the importance of the successful integration of resources within IFAC. So during our conversations with the advisory group, we initially had a lot of questions around the current IAESB pronouncements and what might be the future of these pronouncements, recognizing that the IAESB has done a lot of valuable work that is already available. Now, from the start, when the new model or the different model was announced, there was a strong commitment to retaining, maintaining, and evolving the IESs. And we are focusing on two aspects relevant to that. The first is, how do we make sure that we maintain the credibility? And here we are working on a fit-for-purpose consultation process, keeping in mind that we would like to be agile, effective, and efficient. Second, Looking at authority, we have said that the statement of membership obligation number 2 will continue to provide authority to the IES. And then again, bringing all of this together on a global knowledge exchange platform. On the right of the slide is our recommendation in relation to priorities, starting off with a platform within which the knowledge exchange can take place. And as I said, that is very closely related to IFAC's development of its new website. Moving to adoption and implementation, really understanding the root causes of the lack of adoption and the lack of implementation to make sure that our solutions are really targeted and specific to that root cause analysis. And then focusing on thought leadership and making sure that we are preparing for future-ready professional accountants. Let me talk for a moment about multi-stakeholder engagement. So I spoke about a fit-for-purpose consultation process. We have given this some thought. The recommendation at the moment is that we use various tools to achieve multi-stakeholder engagement, starting off with an online survey, so utilizing our knowledge exchange platform. This could be a continuous survey and to help us to identify developments and relevant topics, to identify potential revisions to the IESs. We then see that going to a key stakeholders forum taking place maybe every second year. And this wide so this would be a forum of a wide range of key stakeholders. This would enable us to obtain a much deeper understanding of the survey findings. And then again, still narrowing these findings, we are suggesting an annual International Accountancy Education Directors Forum. So bringing together the directors maybe of our, we could say, top 30 member organizations. And here we would want to discuss the outcome of the survey and the key stakeholders forum. And then also use this as a platform to discuss with these bodies how can we collaborate, coordinate, and leverage their resources. And all of that, of course, would inform the IFAC activities with the advice of the panel. Next steps, that completes our outline of the model. Our next steps, as I said earlier, you will soon receive a stakeholder survey, and we encourage you to complete that to confirm your level of agreement with where we are to date. We will present to the IFAC board the proposed model in March. We plan another stakeholder update webinar similar to this one for April. And by July, the panel will be formed and the model will become operational. Lastly, we would like the transition advisory group to stay in place until end of August to help us with any small implementation issues that might need attention. With that, Anne-Marie, let me turn over to you to talk more about what the IAESB is doing to facilitate a successful transition to this new model.
Alta, thank you very much, and thank you for walking through the model. I know it's a lot for everyone to take in, but as you can see, there has been significant progress, and it's been well thought out to date, and I think that stepping back and thinking about this holistically, it's a good approach. But let me talk now about what the IASB is doing, and in particular with a sharp focus on ensuring that there's a successful transition and that the panel is set up for success. So first of all, a couple of things. The board is really comprised of some very valuable resources, and we're utilizing all of those resources to focus on our most significant projects. And just as an aside and for everyone's information, you know, the board is comprised of educators, practitioners, regulators, and member organizations that are really coming together, focusing their time and attention, addressing our key priority projects, and then also ensuring some projects that are in process are in a good state and have the appropriate documentation and framework around them that they can then be handed over to IFAC and the panel for successful implementation as well. So first, let's talk about our current significant projects. We have revised IES 7. This is continuing professional development and related implementation guidance, which is expected to be issued in the first quarter of 2019. And I'll add that the task force has been working really hard to bring together the implementation guidance based on significant input from a wide range of stakeholders. In addition, we have issued an exposure draft on targeted revisions to the learning outcomes in IES 2, 3, 4, and 8 on information and communications technologies and professional skepticism. Now, it's essential that we do receive feedback on our exposure draft to really help support producing high quality standards, and certainly recognize that this provides the model, or the panel, if you will, a strong foundation on which to conduct its important objectives. The comment deadline is March 4th of 2019. I cannot stress how important your input is, how valuable it is, how much it means to the board to hear your voice, and to certainly influence the outcome of any revisions to the standards. Now, the board is also working on developing implementation guidance in the form of non-authoritative detailed learning outcomes with an ICT, information and communications technology, public sector, and professional accountants and business perspective. And this is planned to be issued concurrent with the revised IESs. As a board, we recognize the benefit that if there are revised standards, because they are principles-based, is equally important to issue implementation guidance in conjunction with the revised standards. Now, if we move to the next slide, I'll talk a little bit about some of the other projects that we are transitioning. First of all, a couple of things. Really evaluating whether the IESs should be applicable or addressed to more than just member organizations. And that's really just recognizing the importance of the IESs, how it's specific to an accountant and the role that they're performing, and also developing their competencies. Recognizing it's really a multi-stakeholder engagement that it takes to produce, if you will, competent accountants to perform their role to provide high quality services. Really, a question has come up, and we started to evaluate whether there could be benefit of broadening the applicability. The second one is really evaluating the standards. And this goes a little bit to what Alt had said about a root cause analysis. So the root cause analysis is not only going to address why aren't the standards being implemented as expected, but also what's working. And so certainly evaluating the standards, how they're being implemented, what the barriers are, in addition to certainly recognizing that there's barriers associated with structure of accountancy education more broadly, but certainly what can be done to further support the implementation and adoption of the IESs. Another area is behavioral competence. Now, the board has spent significant time and effort on professional skepticism. As I mentioned, that's going to be part of the targeted revisions to certain of the IESs, primarily those in initial professional development. But professional skepticism is just one element of behavioral competence. And certainly in our very significant outreach activities, behavioral competence really was high on the list in terms of the skills and the behaviors that are needed of a future-ready accountant. So that's an area that we're in the process of transitioning, but certainly something that is a great area for the panel and IFAC to focus on. The other one is really evaluating the benefit of combining IES 2, 3, and 4. There are a lot of redundancies amongst the standards, and so there certainly was consideration and support for combining them. It wouldn't eliminate or create an issue with complying with those standards, but rather making them more user-friendly, if you will, by eliminating a lot of the redundancies. I can tell you that the board is a dedicated group, well-qualified, diverse professionals that are absolutely committed to advancing accounting education and ensuring a successful transition to IFAC and to the panel as we conduct our activities through the next year. Thank you, Alta, and I'll turn it back to you.
Thank you so much, Anne-Marie. So what is left for us to do is to receive your observations and questions. We have one question so far, but before I go to the question, let's just recap briefly, and I think I will work from the back to the front. So critical success factors, very, very aware that these factors have to be in place for the model to be successful. So it has to be a strategic focus of IFAC. The output needs to be relevant and authoritative or of a status that would be credible to our stakeholders and internationally recognizable and applied. The issue of resources we have discussed, and also effective operations, particularly internal operations. Then this would be our structure for the model. It would be IFAC-led, where the implementation and operation of the model would be with staff, and they would be advised by the panel. So the panel would be responsible for strategic advice, facilitating access to expertise and resources, and advocacy for quality future-ready professional accountants under IFAC board oversight. And then let me move the operations would be focused on collaboration, coordination, and leveraging internal resources. That's where we would also address issues relating to professional accountants in business and small and medium practitioners. External resources, leverage, collaborate, coordinate, and bringing all of that together on a global knowledge exchange platform. A wide mandate, scope of activities would include what you currently have under the IAESB pronouncements, looking ahead to future-ready professional accountants, thought leadership, focus on adoption and implementation, taking into account the capacity required for successful adoption and implementation. We spoke about advocacy and multi-stakeholder engagement. Most importantly, the guiding principles framing this model, it has to be relevant, responsive, effective, and open. Primarily, we focus on IFAC member organizations and aspiring IFAC member organizations, but we do recognize the wide and diverse range of stakeholders interested in accountancy education. So let me move back to Maria's email address. I went the wrong way. You will have it in a moment. There you go. So go to webinar chat function for your questions, as well as email to Maria. So let's start with the question from my former colleague, Gary Flugraf. Hi, Gary. I hope everything is well with you back home. Thank you for your question. Gary is asking us, will the new panel continue to coordinate with the IAASB and IESBA, so Auditing Standards Board and Ethics Standards Board, directly on specific projects of mutual relevance, and for example, professional skepticism, or will it be IFAC providing input to these relevant projects in the future like other stakeholders? Actually, Gary, it will be IFAC collaborating with the standard setting boards. Our approach we are currently working on is really strengthening our collaboration with the standard setting board. So we foresee it to be IFAC collaborating with those boards on these projects of interest. We have a question from Gabrielle. Gabrielle is asking us, how does this change in collaboration model will affect the current IAESB members? So currently, Gabrielle, we have about 50% of our transition advisory group members from the IAESB, and we also have the IAESB CAG chair on the transition advisory group. We would follow a nominations process for the panel. That process would be similar to the process that we would be applying for IFAC committees. And at the moment, as we are moving ahead to implementing our new strategy, we are also reconsidering our structure and our processes. And so there might be changes to the nominations process, but that ultimately would be what would be used to select the new members. And of course, as I said earlier, these members would be approved by the IFAC board. We have a question from Laura. Laura says, when leveraging the work of IFAC member bodies, who will be responsible for overseeing the quality and relevance of the various external resources being made available? So Laura, we spoke about this model being IFAC staff led. So it would be the responsibility of IFAC staff. And when we spoke about the mandate of the panel, you will recall that the panel would also advise on outputs from this model. Kevin, do we have another question? Another question from Gabrielle. Which body will be in charge of maintaining or updating the IESs? So again, this will be the new panel together with IFAC. Maria, do we have any other questions? We have another question. This question is from my friend Patrick Kabuya. Good evening, Patrick. Your question is, will the model incorporate technicians related qualifications? So this morning, we were talking internally about the knowledge exchange platform, and Kevin here was most excited about how this platform would enable us to make available the work that we are currently doing in developing, in collaboration with one of our member organizations, an example competency framework for technicians. And we are hoping that the platform, that we would be enabled to continue to build on this competency framework via our knowledge exchange platform. So long answer, short answer is yes, definitely. So we have another question about the platform, and the question here is, when will this platform be developed? Again, we started our conversations this morning, and our aim is to work alongside, of course, the development of the IFAC website, but we are hopeful to at least have something in place at the time the new model comes into effect, which would be July 2019. So, Patrick, if I go back to your question around the accounting technicians, just let me use this opportunity, having an audience here, is to say that at the moment we are doing limited consultation on our illustrative competency framework for accounting technicians, and the aim is to have that ready in the first quarter of 2019. Kevin is just looking at some more questions here. Will the IAESB disappear? Yes, in July, the new panel, or I should rather say the new model, would become effective and the IAESB will not continue to exist. I'm just reading this question. We are talking about professional skepticism. And the question here is, how is the model facilitating across all such standards? So very much in line with Gary's question around who will be interacting on these projects or topics that go across the standard setting boards. It will be IFAC collaborating with the standard setting boards on these topics, and of course, IFAC being advised by the panel. Maria, any more questions? We have one more question, and then Kevin, I think after this question, I'll ask you for a few closing remarks and for Anna-Marie to do the same. And all participants, just keep in mind that any of your observations and or questions that we are not responding to today, we will be taking into account together with the findings of the survey. How will the new model, so this is our question, it's from John Hooper, and he is asking about capacity building. So the capacity building work that IFAC is doing, how would this interact with this new model? So John, we do see that capacity building would be within the scope of activities of the new model. And as you are aware, most of the work that we have been doing under the PAO capacity building program relate to education. So we would see that a lot of that would be facilitated through our new model. With that, Kevin, let me hand over to you for closing remarks.
Thanks, Alta. Just had to get my mic on. I just want to make one further comment on that last question about capacity building. We are actually quite hopeful that the new model will be even more effective in the capacity building space, because one of the aspects of the model is to focus not just on standards, but thought leadership, guidance, implementation tools, etc. We hope that there can be a variety of those. And when you look at the length of time to develop those types of tools as opposed to standards, they can be developed more quickly, hopefully deployed more quickly, and we can be more agile and effective as a result. Just in wrapping up, I'd like to thank everybody for participating on the webinar tonight. We also had one earlier today. So we've had a number of participants, and really just wanted to harken back to Alta's comment that we will have a stakeholder survey go out to really have a litmus test or a temperature check in terms of where we are on all the various aspects of the model going forward, so we can continue to refine it and develop it over the coming months. So with those comments, I just pass it back to Anne-Marie for any final comments from her. Thank you.
Thank you, Kevin. And I certainly want to reinforce all the thank yous to a host of individuals, but in particular to the attendees here on the webinar and asking the questions and being actively involved. That's very much appreciated and very much needed. And I want to thank you in advance for two things. Number one, responding to the survey when it goes out. And then also number two, responding to the exposure draft that's been issued by the Education Standards Board. Having these high quality standards are very important to support the success of the model, but most importantly, more broadly, the future of accountancy education and the success of our profession. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Anne-Marie. Thank you, Kevin, and thank you, participants. We wish you a very good rest of the day. Thank you. Bye-bye.